Welcome to Hard Talk. I'm Stephen Sacker. Just how ugly is Britain's divorce from the EU going to be? And how damaging for the unhappy couple? As British MPs debate the formal triggering of the exit process, my guest is an EU politician who will be at the heart of the complex negotiations over a Brexit deal. Belgium's former Prime Minister and current MEP, Guy Verhofstadt, has warned Britain to expect no favours as it heads for the exit. But how confrontational is he prepared to be? Guy Verhofstadt, welcome to Hard Talk.
Yep.
I want to talk about Brexit with you, but I don't want to start with the detail. I want to start with the context. When the British public voted for Brexit on June 23rd, 2016, Barack Obama was President of the United States. Now, the White House is occupied by Donald Trump. To what extent do you think this fundamental shift in global politics, the most important power in the world, after all, how important is that as a context, a changed context for Brexit?
No, I think it gives an opportunity, I think, from the European side to show and to work on more unity. Because let's be honest, what Trump has said since now a few days and a few weeks is very hostile towards Europe. And he is saying openly that he thinks that Europe could disintegrate further.
Yeah, he thinks more European members of the EU will follow Britain out of the exit door. And he thinks that's a good thing.
Yeah, he thinks that it is a good thing to have a disintegrated European Union. While I think it's quite the opposite. The, in fact, the interest of the Americans is not in a disintegrated union. The interest of America is to have a very united European ally. And you can only walk on two legs. You need also Trump needs an American leg. And he needs also a European leg.
Your skeptical view of Donald Trump as president and as an individual, the fact is the European Union needs to be closely allied with the United States of America.
Exactly.
That's one of the pillars of European security policy.
And that is what he is now putting in danger.
Trump. With respect, you are too. Some of the things you've said in recent days are actually extraordinary. You have said, and you said this yesterday, and I'm quoting you, under the enormous political influence of Trump's political adviser, Stephen Bannon, he sent people to Berlin, to Paris, to prepare the ground for similar referendum as that seen in Britain.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, what evidence do you... You're essentially saying that Trump is taking active steps to undermine the European Union.
Well, Steve Bannon has launched Breitbart also in Europe, and everybody knows that's an extreme right-wing news site who is promoting. In fact, extreme right-wing, radical views.
That's not the Trump administration. I mean, you're saying these hostile things about Donald Trump as president, which seem to me to have no evidence at all.
I'm a little bit puzzled that you are saying it's not the Trump administration where Mr. Bannon has been appointed as member of the National Security Council of the U.S.
Yes, of course.
Even
that,
putting
that
outside,
but you actually cited to me something that was happening at Breitbart.
So I think I think it's maybe not the Trump administration, but is Mr. Steve Bannon, the special advisor of Trump. So we can discuss about what the influence is of Mr. Bannon on Mr. Trump. What I see is what Mr. Trump is saying. That's more important. And he
quote.
His quotes are very clear. He says,
well,
yeah,
so are yours.
I hope to be clear. That's the reason why I'm in politics.
You
have politics of politicians, maybe here, who are trying to escape to the questions. I, in my statements, are trying never to escape to the question.
Yeah, well, let's think about
and
your
that makes
choice
it
of
more
words.
Bold, maybe.
No, it makes it fascinating, your choice of words. My view, you say, is that we have a third front that is now undermining the EU, and that third front is Donald Trump. I mean, it's this
exactly.
word I can come back to, hostility. You are downright hostile to what
I'm not hostile. I'm only seeing and I'm only hearing what Mr. Trump is saying.
And you're using the language of warfare.
So, okay, let me explain maybe. I think that we have, first of all, the threat to Europe by radical political Islam, jihadist. Secondly, I think we have a threat by Putin, an autocrat in the Kremlin who tries to divide Europe already years from now. And now we have an American president who is not longer seeing the American the European unity as a pillar for his foreign policy. And he is saying openly he hopes for a disintegration of the European Union. So I think we are very much alone. I think that we are, for the moment, in an existential moment of the European Union. I hope that only my response to this is that only European unity can be a good answer.
Yeah, well, I'm mindful you've just written this book that I've got.
And that's my book about Europe's last chance.
Why the European states, its subtitle, why the European states must form a more perfect union. Ironically, you've taken a phrase from the
American
Constitution.
Yeah. Exactly.
I think it's going to be difficult right now to persuade Europeans that they should be regarding as a model the federal United States of America. But that's obviously...
That's about Trump now. Trump is the same as the American institutions. What I'm seeing is that America, for example, after the financial crisis, was capable to react immediately to that financial crisis. They did a cleaning up of their bank stock, they did an investment program, they did quantitative easing. Well, if I look to Europe, we are not a union, in fact. What we are is, in fact, a loose confederation of nation states still based on the unanimity rule, and we are always acting too little, too late. In the financial crisis, for example, in migration, in refugees. Mm. So this book, I have to tell you, that is even more Eurosceptic than all the Eurosceptic books that have been published in the United Kingdom the last...
Because you think the current formulation of the European Union simply doesn't work. You've just made a very interesting point about the importance of nation states. I mean, what Trump is, and avowedly a self-confessed American nationalist, America first, is his message.
Yep.
And interestingly, that message, which is essentially a nationalist message, is echoed across Europe in different nation states where politicians are winning with a nationalist
message. It's not echoed, it's the opposite. It was first born in Europe. Nationalism has been born in Europe. Nationalism has not been born outside Europe. And what is more over than that, I think it's a very tricky thing what is happening. That is that an American president is bidding on more nationalism in Europe. You know what nationalism in Europe means? That's not nationalism based on values. That's nationalism in Europe based on ethnicity. And what nationalism has done the last 100 years in Europe, we all know it. 20 million of deaths, victims. Programs, the Shoah, all this is based on nationalism. So an American president thinking, European unity is not necessary, let's go back to national identity, to ideas of nationalism, that's playing with fire in Europe. This is not America, this is Europe. Well, we had the Shoah, the Holocaust, we had the programs.
You can cite the events of the 1930s and 40s at me, but let's stick with what's happening today. And let's stick with my opening question about the context for Brexit. And I come back to this basic point about the situation today in Europe. You've just seen Theresa May in the White House with Donald Trump talking about the steadfast alliance between Britain and Europe. You've heard Donald Trump saying that he is going to seek a very quick trade deal with Britain, talking in the most positive terms about Britain post-Brexit. It weakens your hand as an EU negotiator, does it not, that Britain is now looking at this very close relationship with Donald Trump?
I'm not reasoning in that terms, because I know that the interest of the UK is more in Europe than in the US. You know the figures. 44% of the export of Britain goes to the continent, to Europe. Only 12% goes to the US. So whatever free trade agreement is made between the US and the UK, the main interest of the British industry, the British companies, the British workers, the British citizens sits in Europe and is in Europe. And so these negotiations will be very important, and I'm very open about it. I think that fairness is the basic principle we need to apply in this negotiation.
So when Theresa May says, alongside Donald Trump, that as you renew your nation, we renew ours, the opportunity is here to renew the special relationship, the post-EU Britain and Trump's America will lead together again, your response to that is?
My response was yesterday in the streets of London, I think. I have seen thousands and thousands of people who not agree with this. I don't believe in the rhetoric and in the narrative of Trump. I think it is devastating. Also for the American economy, because protectionism, because that's also part of his narrative. How you can make an agreement between the UK, which is an open society, who believes in trade, I think, And at the other hand, an American president who is seeing every trade deficit with whatever country as an existential threat. And there is a trade deficit from the U.S. towards the U.K. So good luck with it. I think that is more interesting for the U.K. authorities to work together on a fair partnership with the European Union, because that is the biggest market for the British industry.
And I want to tease out what you mean by a fair partnership in a moment. But just before we get to the detail of the negotiations, which you will be involved in, just one more specific point, which again, I think arises out of what we're seeing in the United States and what we've heard from Theresa May as well. And that's a question about security. So we'll get to economics, but security. You know as well as I do that Britain has been a linchpin of European security.
Exactly.
Our armed forces are superior to most in Europe. Our intelligence services are superior to most in Europe. If you talk to people in Germany, Poland, the Baltic republics, they all say we need a close security relationship with Britain, come what may, whether Brexit happens
or
not.
That's also my point. I think that we have to discuss not only the economic partnership between the UK and the European Union. It will be necessary, besides that, also to talk about internal and external security. And what I don't want, that is not my position.
But it's leverage from the UK, isn't it?
A minute. What I don't want, that is exactly what I wanted to say. I don't want a trade-off between the economic discussion we will do and, at the other hand, the question of internal and external security. I don't think it's very serious to make a trade-off between
But Germany's already indicated that they...
Yeah, but let's be honest. The most important thing to do on the security issue from the European side is to create a European defense union the fastest as possible. You know the figures.
But if you don't have Britain, it devalues the whole thing.
Okay, may I give the figures? 42% we spent in Europe on military. And we are only capable to do 10 to 12% of the operations of the American army. So I'm not a mathematician, I'm a lawyer, but I know that it means, these figures, that we are 3 to 4 times less effective. And why we are less effective? Because we don't have a European defense community. We duplicate everything 28 times between the 28 member states. So I think this whole discussion, also on security, internal, externally, is a good chance to create finally what we needed already to do decades ago, that's to create a European Defence Union.
Right. Well, let's now...
That's also in the book.
Yes. Let's get to the nitty-gritty of negotiating a complex deal with the UK on its departure from the European Union. Just some very quick-fire practical questions. You said recently that you thought getting a trade deal within the two-year time frame was impossible. You stick to that?
I think that's impossible, yeah. Everybody knows that it's impossible.
Well, they don't know it's impossible in London. If you talk
to
the ministers responsible,
the people
they say it's entirely possible.
Talking with know that very well, what we're going to do in this 14, 15 months, but it's not 2 years, it's 14, 15 months. Because at the end of the process, before the end of 2018, we need to start a consent procedure in the European Parliament. Because it's the European Parliament who has to give the green light for the final agreement. So we're going to start, end of May, beginning of June, that gives us a time frame of 14 or 15 months. What can you do in this 14 or 15 months? Realistically, I think the withdrawal agreement is the first thing to do. Not an easy thing, I can tell you.
That if to put it in common parlance, that's the divorce agreement. Before you get to the new relationship, you have to do the divorce.
Well, yeah, and then you have also to define your new relationship, but in general terms.
But do you do them in tandem? Because there's a big debate about whether the two sets of negotiations, one about the divorce arrangements and one about the new relationship.
There cannot be a discussion about, take the treaty. The treaty, Article 50, is very clear. The treaty is saying, first of all, you start with your withdrawal agreement.
So you do
in them... In the light of your... of the framework of the future relationship. So you need to have an idea, not more than that, about your future relationship, and then you can conclude your withdrawal agreement. To continue then, with, for example, if it is an FTA, a free trade agreement, it will take years. It will take the whole...
How many years in your opinion?
I think the whole period of transition. And the period of transition will be 2 years, 3 years. So, besides the 2 years we have now, or the 40 or 15 months where I'm talking about, you will need the whole transition period to conclude what it be the final agreement with the UK. That's a realistic time.
There are cracks appearing, it seems to me, in the EU's position on some of the key fundamental principles of a negotiated deal. You've said the four freedoms that underpin the single market, they're not going to ever be negotiated upon, and there'll be no cherry picking.
Yep.
Others have sent signals suggesting that there can be sector-by-sector deals, which, while Britain leaves the single market, will allow Britain preferential access to certain sectors of that single market. Is that possible?
There will be no cherry-picking. Nobody of the three institutions of the EU will accept that. So Mrs. May have indicated she wants to go out of the Union, out of the single market, out of the customs union, out of the European Court of Justice, and then saying, oh, but that is a EU program that interests me, and that is a sector that interests me. That will not happen, sorry. Because then she has to take also the obligations and the payments were linked to these advantages. You can never create a status outside the European Union who is more advantageous than to be member of the European Union. It should not be fair towards the members of the European Union and towards our taxpayers.
You want to believe that there can be no cherry picking, but others have sent a different message. Even Mr. Barnier, who is, with all due respect, probably more important to the negotiations than
you. Yeah, that's true.
Because he's negotiating on behalf of the Commission.
He is negotiating, and we have to approve his negotiations.
Exactly. So we are less important. He's a negotiator, and he, according to a leak that the Guardian newspaper got hold of, told MEPs that there needed to be a special relationship between big finance, the City of London.
That has been denied two times by Mr. Barnier.
You know, in the nature of politics, he had to deny it because it was an unauthorized leak.
No, sorry, I was there in that meeting, and he has never said that. I was in that meeting. It was a meeting of the Conference of Committee Chairs of the European Parliament. I was present as the Brexit negotiator for the European Parliament, and he never said that. Be assured of one thing, cherry-picking, we shall not allow
it. So when the German car industry, for example, pleads with the German government and says, look, be real, and I'm quoting now the head of the Federation of German Industry, imposing trade barriers, imposing protectionist measures between the EU and Britain or between the two political centres, on the EU on one hand, UK on the other, would be a very, very foolish thing to do.
Yeah, but
that's
speaking. Yeah, I agree with all this. I'm against protectionism myself, but that's not the point. It's not the point about protectionism. It's the point is if, for example, that's in any way, I think, still the best option, that is that the UK should ask for to be part of the single market, to continue to be part of the single market, at the same time accepting the four freedoms of the European Union. The problem doesn't start with the European Union. The problem starts with the UK government saying, oh, the freedom of movement of people inside the European Union, we don't like it because there are Polish people coming to work on our construction sites here in London, we don't like it. I think that these people are very necessary in the UK economy. You know what the labour mobility in Europe is? 1%. You know what the labour mobility in the US is? 10%. 10 times bigger. And one of the reasons that we have 2 million of vacancies in Britain and in Europe is because we have not enough labour mobility.
Isn't the truth, Mr. Verhofstadt, that you take the position you take, no cherry-picking, no negotiation on these sector deals, you take that position because you're deeply insecure. You worry that if Britain is seeking to get a deal that works for Britain, that actually makes the British economy successful, that it will encourage others in Europe to follow Britain to the exit door. You're deeply insecure about the fragility
and vulnerability of the European Union.
The
problem of the future of the European Union is not so much linked to the Brexit negotiation. The problem of the future of the European Union is linked to the courage and the willingness of the European leaders for the moment to go forward, like I describe in this book, with the unity and the integration of the European Union, creating a defense community, creating an economic governance for the single currency, creating an external border and coast guard. So the future of the European Union is depending on that. And not so much, I think, on
Mr. Verhofstadt, you've been writing books, with all due respect, about the need for a federal Europe for an awful long time. You wrote The United States of Europe in 2006.
As Prime Minister.
You wrote another book in 2009 called How Europe Can Save the World Emerging from Crisis. You know, you have written these books, which now look like museum pieces.
No,
Europe's moved on.
Sorry.
Europe's politicians are no longer talking about union and federation.
No, it is the opposite what is happening. You are laughing a little bit with my books, but at the same time, I was the one who said we need a banking union before we can overcome the financial crisis. In the meanwhile, you agree that the banking union is now in place. I was
one of the European leaders. How Europe can save the world was your title in 2009. Frankly, Europe has done nothing to save the world in the last 7 years.
Because we didn't have the institutions on the European level that was necessary. I already explained to you, we are still a loose confederation of nation states based on the unanimity rule, in which we act always too little too late. And the financial crisis, I have described it in the book, is a typical example of that. And I said we need a banking union. Today we have a banking union. I can tell you, they have laughed at me as prime minister when I proposed a number of initiatives on the defense union. Today, these initiatives, European headquarters, for example, are on the table.
When you talk like this, Mr. Verhofstadt, you play into the hands of people like Nigel Farage, one of the most important leaders of the Leave campaign in the UK, when he says you are a dangerous fanatic, and he says you have long been anti-British to the core.
That's a completely nonsense. You know, I'm racing with an old car. It's a 1954 right-hand drive Aston Martin. How can you be more British than that?
Well, I tell you, I look at your own words and I wonder about your attitude to Britain. You said in 2016, according to Politico, the website, quote, politically, the UK is already on its way to becoming an adversary rather than a trusted partner of the EU. Is that how you see the UK today,
Certainly, that is what Mr. Farage is exactly standing for. When I'm attacking him, I'm attacking not Britain. I'm attacking somebody who wants to destroy the European Union.
The UK is on its way to becoming an adversary. Is that the way you feel about the UK
today? No, absolutely not. What I'm feeling about is that we can find a fair partnership. But people like Mr. Farage, who are at the heart of the Brexit campaign and who are really to destroy the European Union, that's our problem. That's my the thing what they're going to fight
The thing is, it's not really just about Britain, is it? When you said of the Brexit campaign, you described it as the latest high mass of tribalism in Europe.
Yeah.
It isn't just actually in Britain where people are expressing great scepticism about the European Union, great scepticism about immigration and its effect upon Europe.
Yep.
You could look at Le Pen in France.
Yeah, well,
look
Wilders,
at Wilders in the Netherlands. Yeah. Look at Poland. Look at Hungary. Look at so many nations across the European Union.
I don't deny this. I'm fighting against these people. I don't deny that Le Pen exists. I don't deny that Wilders exists. But I can tell you one thing. The public opinion on the continent, in our countries, in the European Union, is not against Europe. They are against this European Union. That's exactly why I'm saying to you, this book is maybe more Eurosceptic than all other books that have been published. Because I think that this European Union will not survive. What you need to do to convince also people that are voting today for Wilders, of Le Pen, that's offering a vision of the future, showing them that unity of Europe can tackle the financial crisis, the economic fallout of it, the migration flows, the refugees coming to Europe, the insecurity externally.
You've been peddling the federalist dream for 10 years. Yeah, At what point are you going to realize it is a dream and not reality?
Exactly. The banking union today is a reality because we have pushed for it. I think also tomorrow, European Defence Union will be a reality because the world is changing and we cannot count longer on Mr. Trump. So it will arrive. I see, for example, what's happening in France, French presidency. Macron, you're following it, what he is saying about Europe? It's a Frenchman who is saying, well, sovereignty, we don't find sovereignty anymore on the national level. We need it on the European level. Let's say a Frenchman who is saying that, that's somebody you have to invite in Hot Talk, the fastest as possible, I should say.
And we'll get you back to discuss the state of Brexit in a few months or years' time. But for now, we have to end right there. Guy Verhofstadt, thank you for being on Hot Talk. Thank you very much indeed.